Dear Father in Heaven, thank you for another opportunity to come together and study these truths that you have revealed to us. Please guide us and be with us. Give us clarity of mind and help us to understand these things, these patterns, these symbols, Lord. And bless us with all the gifts of the Holy Spirit that we need to do the work and help us to prepare for the soon coming of the close of probation, Lord. We ask you all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we have a new version, 5.7 of the notes. They can be downloaded from the YouTube channel. So please do that. We continue with our study of July 18. We left off our previous presentation with on page 24. We were looking at a possible date for Penium. We have Wafia. We have a date for Wafia. November 9, 2019. I think it's on this side of the board. We have a date for Wafia, which is the close of probation for the priest internally, and of course the externally the defeat. Or Russia will defeat USA. USA will suffer a defeat by the hand of Russia. We have July 18. We saw July 18 coming up in several lines. And now we look at Panium. The question is July 18 a part of Panium, or is it a... Sorry? Okay, thank you. Is November 9, is December 25 a possible date for Panium? That is what we will look into. December 25, 2021. Jeff showed that 2021 could likely be is a likely date for Panium based on the 2 25 20s, and we will continue to look into this to come up with a possible date for Panium. And the question is July 18 connected to Panium? Are we dealing with a point or a period considering Panium? So that is what you look into. I've drawn some lines on this board because we notice that on page 25. Since we have 2021 as a likely date for Panium, there were other indications that pointed towards 2021. For example, we had a 30-year period from 1989 to 2019. If you look at the ministry of Christ, and come and parallel it with the movement, we see, if we say that Christ was born in 1989, if we say the movement was born in 1989, 12 years later, the temple building started, just like Christ was 12 when he started his carpentry. started to work as a carpenter. Then 18 years later, Christ was ready to begin his ministry. And we also, 18 years later, we come at 2019, November 2019, we have to be ready as priest. We still have the binding off to face. We don't know how long this will last, but like we said, 2021 is a likely date that for Panim, where the binding off will end. We also see on this line, which also starts at 1989, if you look externally to the events that happened, we see the fall of the Berlin Wall on November 9, 1989. 2 years later, we see the Soviet Union being dissolved on December 25, 1991. And then 30 years from there, we also arrive at 2021, which again is a most likely date for Panim. And it was suggested by Stephen Jameson that a possible date was suggested that it could possibly be also December 25, 2021. Where Panim would be, where Russia would be defeated by the USA. So we see the 30 years also showing up on this line, which was the reason why we tried to take December 25 as a possible date for Panim. And we did this. We took December 25 as a likely date for Panim, and we put it on a structure, and we got this structure as a result. Yes.
Is my question being picked up, Larry?
Yes.
When you have 1989 and 1991, yes, you're identifying the two dates that we use to mark the time of the end.
Right.
Okay, so that's part of the strength of that presentation.
Yeah.
The one time of the end identifies 30 years internal. It's talking about the development of priests.
Right.
And then in 1991, it's an external, about the external warfare. The collapse of the Soviet Union is ending with the collapse of Russia. Russia being the fullness of your concept.
Correct.
In the sense that we thought in that history that the Soviet Union was the king of the South, but we later found out it was Russia. So there's a connection. It's external, but there's a connection between the collapse of the Soviet Union and the collapse of Russia, most
Correct.
Likely.
Correct.
Okay.
Yes, thank you. So when we took December 25 as a possible date for Panim, we placed it on the line and see what would result of this. So now we have Rafia at November 9, 2019. We have July 18 in 2020. And we have December 25 in 2021. So here we know this is the close operation for the priest internally. Externally, we will see the USA suffering a defeat by the hand of Russia. Here we have only an external event, Islam. And here we have internally the second coming for the priest. And the externally, it is where Russia will be defeated by the USA permanently. So the question is, how does July 18 fit in? Is it part of Panem, meaning that Panem would be a period of time? Because we saw that we know that Panem is called the Midnight Cry, but we also see a lot of symbology connected, Midnight Cry symbology connected with July 18, 2020. So this whole period could be considered as Panem. This is the beginning of Panem and this is the end of Panem. But for now we call this Panem, December 25, 2021. But nevertheless, this whole structure shows some interesting patterns, which we will look at.
Can I throw one more thing in before you go into the patterns?
Yes.
We understand a 10-year proxy war that leads to 1989, the collapse of the Soviet Union. That 10-year proxy war was between the King of the North, the King of the South, between Russia and the United States in an Islamic country. And that war began in 1979 on December 25th. So we see at the beginning of the proxy war associated with Russia, December 25th, and then with the Soviet Union. And then in 1991, we see the collapse of the Soviet Union, December 25th. So we have two witnesses that is associated with the Soviet Union or Russia that lead us to December 25th, 2021.
Correct.
But I would argue when you get to, and I'm sure you may or may not be going there, I would argue that when you get to marking Panem or Panem on December 25th, 2021, that Jesus illustrates the end from the beginning, and the collapse of the Soviet Union took place there at the time of the end from 1989 to 1991. It was a progressive collapse.
Yes.
So it speaks to me that Panem, the battle that is going to take Russia out, is not a singular battle, it is a progressive battle.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you. So we go to the next page, page 26. And the first thing we see is that it is exactly 777 days between November 9, 2019 and December 25, 2021, which is interesting number right there. But that in itself doesn't mean anything, of course, but if you look at the second point, number two, we see that November 9, 2019, July 18, 2020, and December 25, 2021 are all on a Sabbath, which is the seventh day, of course. So then we mark three Sabbaths. November 9, this is on the seventh day, July 18, 2020. It's on the seventh day, and December 25, 2021 is also on a Sabbath. So also here we see three sevens, 777. Just like the period between December 25 and November 9 is also 777 days. In the third point, if you take the word value of Panem and Wafia and calculate the difference between the word value, it's very interesting to see that
the word value, what does that mean?
The word value means that like we did with the word Peter in Matthew 16:18, right? It added up, but it multiplied to 144,000. I'm sure we remember that.
The letter where it's located in the alphabet.
Exactly.
Assigning numbers to
the A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, and so forth, etc. So if you do this with Wafia, we get the R is the 18th letter, we added two, the A is one, plus 16, the P, the H is 8, the I is 9, and the A again is 1. We add this up, we get the number 53. We do the same with Panyim. 16 plus 1 plus 14 plus 9 plus 21 plus
3. 13. You
have in your notes. 13. Is 74. So if we, I should have done it on the other way around. But if we subtract 74, 53 from 74, we get the number 21. And the 21, of course, is 7 plus 7 plus 7, which equals this symbolically this period between Panim and Raphia. Do we see this? Did we go too fast? Okay. So, three times we see a 777 appearing. This being the third time. So, yeah, it shows that this number, numerical patterns like we saw in Peter, is not there just for the nicety of it, for fun. It's, we have to do something with it, right? We have to apply it. And this is what we did right here. We go to the next bullet point. Have a question?
Evangelicals have noticed a lot of these 777s coming up with Donald Trump, and that they see a lot of significance with Donald Trump in connection with the State of Israel. And for example, they've noticed that Donald Trump won the presidential election on the same day as the Israeli Prime Minister Ben Netanyahu, if I pronounce his name right. It was Netanyahu's seventh year, seventh month, and seventh day in office when Donald Trump won the election on the 8th, well, the Hinckley Margaret on the 8th of November. But we didn't know that he won the election until the 9th. So Donald Trump was born 700 days before Israel declared independence, and therefore 777 days after Trump's birth, the modern nation of Israel was 77 days old. And then the opening ceremony for the US Embassy in Jerusalem started at 4 p.m. on the 14th of May, 2018. This was 70 years to the hour that Israel's first would-be Prime Minister, David Ben-Gurion, stood up to read the Israeli Declaration of Independence on the 14th of May in 1948. So the embassy's opening ceremony was 700 days after Donald Trump's 70th birthday. On his first full day in office, Donald Trump was exactly 70 years, 7 months and 7 days old in the rabbinic Hebrew year 5777. He beat Hillary Clinton by 77 votes in the Electoral College because of 7 faithless electors. And 2 voted against Donald Trump, while 5 voted against Hillary Clinton, bringing the final tally to 304 to 227 votes. On the July the 7th, 2017, Donald Trump met Vladimir Putin for the first time face-to-face when Vladimir Putin was 777 months old. So I'm just putting this out here. There's a lot of 777s being noticed by the evangelicals, and they're putting a lot of emphasis that Donald Trump is, in some way, God's man for the hour. They're seeing him having like a...
They see this a lucky number, maybe.
they're seeing him as a blessing. Yeah. To, even though they see him...
They see him as Cyrus.
Yes, Cyrus as well. They've done a coin marking the 70 years to restore and build Jerusalem that Donald Trump was putting the embassy back. That was after 70 years of the State of Israel.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of connections there. And even though they see Donald Trump as like an impure vessel, you know, they like Cyrus, that God can still use him to achieve things. And right. So they're making that connection. And these 777s are, they're sort of like pointers to them that suggest that he's going to do some work for God, even though he's they don't agree with his lifestyle.
Do you have that all in a file?
Yes.
Where, I mean, you could put that, we can add that to the live stream?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, we need that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's you know, fluff or icing on the cake, but it's saying that history is about Donald Trump, right? 777.
Mm-hmm. But, yes?
You know, the number 7 is emphasized and all of that, and of course, the evangelicals are misinterpreting that. Sister White, I want to remind us, in Acts of the Apostles 5:85 says the number 7 indicates completeness and is symbolic of the fact that the message is extending to the end of time. She's of course talking about the messages of the seven churches, but still, just the part that says the number 7 indicates completeness. Completeness reminds me of the fact that this is the end. And Donald Trump is the last president. Completeness.
To the end of the time of the USA.
Yes.
You can also point us to the Sunday law, right? The second day?
Yeah.
The coming Sunday law?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Amen. Thank you. If we continue to the next point, number 4, the 777 days between December 25, 2021 and November 9, 2019. This happens only once every 28 years because of the leap year of 2020 and in combination with these 3 days being a Sabbath, each one of them. This happens once every 28 years. So that's pretty rare. But if we even take into account that July 18, 2020 is on the 26th day of the fourth month, both on the biblical and rabbinical calendar, this has never occurred in history, in fact. So it's a unique alignment of dates that we see here. So that's very interesting. I checked it, and Theodore Turner double-checked it. And he came to the same conclusion. This configuration of dates has never happened before. So it shows unique, yes. In Earth history, it has never occurred before. For these dates to be on a Sabbath, November 9, July 18, December 25. And also for July 18 to be on the 26th day of the fourth month, both on the biblical and rabbinical calendar. And the 777 days between it. So that's pretty unique.
So there is no law probability for that one?
No.
It just happens one time,
yes.
And one time only.
Amen. That's correct. If you move forward and look to the next part. The movement lately has thought that 2520 is the key that unlocks time. Or in other words, we are able to set time based on the 2520.
I don't mean to interrupt. this is something I realized after the fact last week, where I was saying that the time, I mean, the restriction goes. Oh, okay, never mind. I need to think this through before I open my mouth.
All right. So it has been said by the movement that the 2520 is the key that unlocks time. And it's interesting that recently, in the past few weeks, it was discovered that Chaim Edson also he referred to the 2520 as being the key to unlock the prophetic understanding. He referred to Colossians 1, verse 26. He referred
to his seven articles.
Yes.
That was his point of reference, that the 2520 is what unseals the increase of knowledge.
Yes.
It's Colossians 1:26.
New Review and Herald, January 10, 1856, Times of the Gentiles, number 15. He refers to the... Maybe we can read the verse? The first part of Colossians 1:26.
You want me to read? I can read it.
Yeah.
Okay. Even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to the saints.
Thank you.
So, it's in chapter 1, verse 26.
That's my point.
You know how... I'm still trying to grapple with this, but you know how the 2520, I forget which one it is, the one that ends in 1844, that's the Southern Kingdom?
Yes.
Anyway, and you have that the 19 years that extends to 1863.
Yep.
Okay. And then it's in 1863. Actually, it's 1844. But 1863 begins the restriction for the Adventist Church in setting time. And that's right there at the 120, at the beginning of the 126. And then you have the mystery of God. I'm trying to piece all this together in my mind. I need some help. But you have the mystery of God.
Those are those two on the bottom board. That's what you're dealing with. The top line on the bottom is the 2520s, and the bottom is the parallel 126s.
Yes. But what I'm trying to grapple with is, and this is kind of off the subject, but in dealing with Revelation 10:7, Revelation 10:7. But the mystery of God should be finished.
Verse 7.
So you have the mystery of God in there in Colossians 1:26. Anyway.
All right. You want to add something?
No, I think he's trying to piece together how it gets sealed up in 1863, and then that time period, Sister White's putting a restriction on time setting. But when we get to 9/11 and the angel comes down, you're at the parallel to the angel coming down on August 11th, 1840. And at that point in Millerite history is the pronouncement, time shall be no longer. So when we get to the parallel point at 9/11, you'll see the reverse of that. And we see the parallel histories of Millerite history, our history, and now the restriction about time setting is removed. And we see that restriction removed with our understanding of the 126 projecting us into that history into 2014. And that's Colossians 1:26, and that was Hiram Edson's point of reference. But I'm not sure that I'm reading his mind correctly. I'm just trying to figure out.
Well, you know, it says, on the notes, it says, the movement has taught that the 2520 unlocks time.
That's what Hiram Edson says, too.
Yes, he does. He does. Yet, it is not at the end of the 2520, but at the end of that 19 years that you then you have the restriction.
Really? I might argue that. I think Sister White was restricting them from setting time before 1863.
Yeah, actually it's 1844 because that's when time,
Okay, so you got the restriction in 1844.
Yes.
So this restriction would get removed where 1844 lines up in our history probably, somewhere in there. Which in those lines up there is 2014. If everyone follows that logic. But this is his argument. He gets to defend it.
Yeah, I saw it was interesting to me that you have the Colossians 1:26, you have the 2520, and it just spoke to what I've been looking at anyway.
Right.
You may have already mentioned this and I may have missed it in the notes, but you see where you have the 252 over there on the top right hand corner? The 252 is between, yes?
Yeah.
2 plus 5 is 7, then 2 plus 5 on the 525 is 7, and 2 plus 5 is 7. So there's another 777.
Yes. You have 7, 7, 7. Yeah? Interesting.
Uh-oh. You created a monster.
Thank you. So very interesting to see that Hiram Edson also refers to the 2520 as the key to unlock prophetic time, and referring to Colossians 1:26, and 1:26 of course is Hiram Edson didn't know that, but 1:26 symbol of course of the 2520. Do we see that?
Yeah.
That's okay. Cool. Yeah. Going to point six, bullet point number six. There are exactly 252 days between Raphia and July 18. 252, of course, a symbol of the 2520. The 525 days between July 18, 2020 and Panyim could be seen as a first number, 525, if you write it like this. And if you go to Daniel 5, verse 25, can anyone read that verse? Daniel 5, verse 25.
And this is the writing that was written, Meni, Meni, Tekel, Upharsin.
Yeah, thank you. So, what is that referring to? 2520, right? So we see another 2520 there. Many, many tekel upharsin, adding up to 1:26 and converting it to geras, you get 2520. Bullet point number 8. If we take July 18, 2020, and we write it as the day, the month, and the year. If you multiply this, you also get 2520. Right there. So we see a lot of 2520 showing up in our structure, which can in no way be all coincidence, right? So we have to see the hand of Pomona in all this. I hope you recognize that and do something with it. Going to the next page 27.
Even you can anyone could correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't know what it is, but Theodore also, and he'll correct me for sure, even if you don't, he has some kind of mathematical justification for taking a 252 there, followed by a 525, and saying that they're the same because they're inverted or whatever. The right. 252 is a 525 because it's the same numbers, and if you just, I don't know if invert's the right word.
Yeah, inverted.
But Theodore identifies some of those phenomenons in his studies as well. So
yeah.
At that level, and I don't know how to justify it, the 525 is also a 252, and the 252 is also a 525.
Yeah, you can look at like that.
And you can also do July, that's month 7, plus 18,
yeah,
25, and then the year 20.
25, 20, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Just by
thank
adding
you.
It. The
yeah,
second
thank you.
Monster comes to life.
So...
Back to the statement where it says the movement has taught that the 25-20 unlocks time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and the meaning there in verse 26, I mean, the Bible itself even translates it. God has numbered thy kingdom.
Amen.
So, and in the word numbered, just it means to count, appoint, ordain, set. So just embedded in the 25-20 is the idea of unlocking time.
Amen.
And setting time.
And setting time.
Yes. Pretty deep. Thank you for that. If you quickly go to the next bullet point, on top of page 27, we saw that the 525 could refer to Daniel 5:25, but it can also refer to Genesis 5:25. And if somebody can read that verse.
And Methuselah lived 187 years and begot Lamech.
So right there we see what number? Which symbolizes what?
The 10th of July.
Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
July 18?
Mm-hmm.
So we read about Methuselah being 187 years old when he got Lamech. And how old became Lamech when he died?
777.
Which verse is it? I forgot to mention the first number. Genesis, same chapter.
Verse 31.
Can somebody read verse 31?
All the days of Lamech were 777 years and he died.
So we see a 777 there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in Genesis 5:25. We read about Methuselah, who was 187 years old when he got Lamech. And Lamech became 777 years old. So we see in one verse a reference to July 18 and a reference to 777, right?
Mm-hmm.
Correct? And if you look at the meaning of the name Lamech, we discovered that Lamech means wild man.
Yeah.
We discovered this in the Eastern Bible Dictionary, which by itself is a little bit interesting because Eastern means out from the east, situated in the east. So that's on a side note. But there's only one passage in the whole Bible where it mentions the wild man. Which of course is Genesis 16:11 and 12, talking about Ishmael. being the wild man. And Ismael, of course, is who? Father of Islam, the patriarch of Islam. So now we see Lamech connected with Islam. And if we do the same thing with the name Lamech, like we did here with Raphia and Panim, like we did with Peter, if we do the same thing with Lamech, and we multiply 12 by 1 by 13 by 5 by 3 and 8. If you multiply all these numbers, we get a very interesting number, 18, 7, 20.
Where do you get those numbers from the letters?
Yeah, A is 1. A is the first letter in the alphabet,
oh,
right?
I see. 26, okay.
Yeah. If you multiply this together, you get 18,720. You see, July 18 in the year 2020. You see that? Oh, sorry. So that's pretty, like Jeff would say, profound, right there. And this was discovered, by the way, on the Sabbath of April 26. April 26, 26th day of the fourth month. So, was very interesting to notice also. But I have not mentioned it here, but we see Pomona at work, and it was a very solemn moment when this was discovered. If we go on and to the next section, the 273 and 391 connection, we already made the connection between the tidings out of the north and out of the east. On this board, on this side, where we saw that Sister Tess emphasized the message from the north, whereas Theodore Turner emphasized Islam. And we also know that the number of Tess was what number? That she emphasized 273, right, from X 27, and numbers 3. And the number that Theodore Turner emphasized was which number?
391.
So if you look at the connection of these two numbers, we can see the following. The 5 to 5 days between this Islamic event, tidings out of the east, and the last battle between USA and Russia, tidings out of the north, this 5 to 5 can be divided in a 252 and a 273. So here we see the symbol for the 2520 or time setting. Here we see the symbol for tidings out of the north, pointing towards an event between Russia and USA. And from October 13, we see a 391 and a 252. Pointing to an Islamic event on July 18, 2020. So there seems to be a connection there. You see a time setting symbol combined with a number 273 or 391.
So you're saying that Kes, on her study of Acts 27, adds to the mix the number 273, yeah. And that becomes a symbol of the struggle between the King of the North and the King of the South.
Right.
And this history from July 18th to December 25th can be divided into a period of 273 and of 252.
Right.
And the 252 is a symbol of Islam. So we have both of those players, Russia and Islam, East and the North, in this history. And the message of the hours is the tidings of the East and the North.
Correct.
But Paneum can be understood as two battles, the Battle of Paneum and the Battle of Actium. Mm-hmm. So we see two antagonists in those numbers in that history for the United States. May very well come in that order, huh?
Yeah. Amen. Thank you. And also, if you look at the number 391, the 391, if you multiply 3 by 91, we get the 273. So you see both symbols. Symbolically connected to each other.
Where did you get the 3? 273.
Yeah, but
the 9 times 3. 391, he's breaking it apart.
3
times
91.
3 times 91.
Oh, 3 times
91.
The 391,
the symbol
of Islam.
I thought
you
said
3
times 9.
Okay.
And then do it with the other one.
With? With what? With this?
Yeah.
2 times 73?
No, 3 times 27.
3 times 27.
91.
It's
91.
3.
Oh, come on.
Close.
Close.
There is evidence from the Bible that supports the concept that the 273 and the 391 can be connected by multiplying 3 by 91 to equal 273. In the passage in Numbers chapter 3, where there is a requirement for the children of Israel to pay Aaron and his sons 5 shekels for each of the 273 firstborn children that were over the number of the Levites. It is noted that the shekel is worth 20 gerahs. That's in verse 47. A total of 1,365 shekels were paid. That's, you find that in Numbers 3, chapter 3, verse 50. This equates to 27,300 gerahs. In Numbers 1:1, it tells us that the book of Numbers begins on the first day of the second month, which is a month after the tabernacle was reared up. You find that in Exodus 40, verse 17. If the book of Leviticus chronologically is before the book of Numbers, and therefore all the events in Leviticus occur in the first month, then Aaron had only 2 sons by the time of Numbers chapter 3, as Nadab and Abihu had been killed when fire came from the Lord. If the 1,365 shekels was given to Aaron and his 2 sons that remained equally, this would equate to 455 shekels each. In the value of gerahs, it comes to 3 times 9,100. So you could sort of see there 3 times 91 there in that division of the in the value of gerahs of them shekels for the 273 Levites. So it's maybe a bit. We can maybe add that to the.
That's something you have to really read more than once.
Yeah.
And it makes you wonder why anyone is looking at that depth of these faiths.
But what were the numbers? What were the divided numbers you said between the last 2 sums? It was 13 something, but you said if you split that in half, that comes out to like 9.
Well, what I'm saying, for the value in gearers that was paid for the 273 extra Levites. To make up that number, it was 27,300 gearers. And then there's only three sons of Aaron that was to be given to Aaron and his sons. So there's only three of them. So that if they got, that was, if that sum was divided then equally between them, it would be 3 times 91,000. So it's like a three, sort of connects with that figure. What we can do is maybe add it to the live stream or whatever. People can study.
It would be divided between two sons. Numbers
are
off.
And him.
Aaron.
And Aaron.
Yeah, yeah. No, I didn't get the third one. Or yes, the first one. The numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had that for sure.
Right. Thank you. The binding off, as you know, takes place between Raphia and Panium, after which we see the church triumphant, if you can say it like that.
Of the priest.
The binding off for the priest.
Well, he hasn't at this point taken a position, I guess, but he raised an issue early on saying, he raised the issue, is Panium a point in time or a period of time? And I think what he's shown is that Panium is a period of time that begins July 18th, 2020, but he can correct me, and ends on December 25th, 2021.
Correct.
So therefore, if it's a period of time that begins on July 18th, 2020, then the binding off ends there.
Yeah.
In December.
No, on July. It would end on July 18th, 2020, of the priest. The Levites begin to come in.
The Levites would end probably on December 25th.
Right.
Right?
Yes. In theory. Is that?
Yeah.
That's proposed anyway.
December 25th is a little bit vaguer for these guys than some others, but it seems pretty clear to me.
But if you
that's
look at
the end.
Yeah, this is
Christmas.
The end of Panium. If we look at the biblical date, it's the 20th day of the ninth month. Which date we see in Ezra chapter 10, verse 9. It talks about the decree now fully in effect. The third decree is now fully instantiated.
The third decree comes into history before then,
yeah.
But it allows them to exercise both civil and religious
authority.
Legal authority,
right.
And they begin to exercise it on the 20th day of the ninth month, as yeah. identified in Ezra 10:9.
Correct.
What does that say about anything?
But
there's a decree there that's going into effect, right?
Yeah.
Prophetically, it's 70 days after the
10th day of the 7th month. So you could also mark that it being at the end of a 7 as well. As being, if you want to take 70 as a symbol of the 7.
Right.
Yeah, it's just it's a time of great rain as well, and separation. Separation of wives.
There's a decree.
Mm-hmm.
So what they're hesitating to say is not so much that that's the end of the period of we're calling Panium, but there is characteristics that suggest that is the Sunday law in the United States.
Mm-hmm. The 25th. Yeah. December the 25th in history was the date in 274 AD when the Roman Emperor Aurelian set up a temple to the sun, and that was when sun worship became the main, sort of was exalted in the Roman Empire. It was probably there before, but in a sense there was like added emphasis to the 25th of December, you know, with sun worship at that there time. There's other events. I think Clovis was baptized in 496 AD. So it's like, yes. And Charlemagne was crowned by the Pope, head of the Holy Roman Empire, on the 25th of December in the year 800 AD. So there's like a lot of events you can maybe connect with the 25th of December that you can maybe tie in to the 25th of December 2021.
And put emphasis to the idea that that's a Sunday law.
Yes.
And another thing that you could tie in is if July 18th, 2020 is the beginning of Paniam and it's the midnight cry, we've already established in this movement that that's the first Sunday law of a series of Sunday laws that leads to the Sunday law. So that period of time begins with a Sunday law. That period of time should end with a Sunday law, because Jesus illustrates the end from the beginning. So Odylio has been a little bit hesitant about saying much about December 25th, but are you going to put those dates in your notes too? We want those dates in there too, about Clovis.
Yeah.
So we have to look more into this, what it really means. The last point I want to make about this structure is, if we count back 273 days from December 25, if you count back 273 days, we arrive at March 27th. And March is which month of the year? Yeah. Third month of the year, so we have a 273 year also.
It's the what month of the year?
Third month.
April?
Oh no, that's not the biblical calendar, your calendar,
Gregorian. Our calendar. It's interesting.
So you got 273 mark at the beginning of this period of 273 days.
Yes. Correct. So we see this whole structure is full of, how do you say, pregnant with symbology, connected to 10-5-20, July 18, 273, 391. And it seems to fit perfectly. So this whole structure seems, based on the patterns that we see, seems valid.
So if the practice of setting time is erroneous, and in doing so, we're opposing a thus saith the Lord, and at some point in time we're all going to stand before the judgment bar of God, that I don't want to be sacrilegious, but when I'm standing before the judgment bar of God and find out that time setting was not something we're supposed to be doing, my argument, and you would never argue with God, I get this, but my argument would be is that this is so complete, so fabulous in the revelations of these various symbols, that I would plead the Lord's mercy if his signature really wasn't on that. I would argue with him, why did you allow this to happen in this complete a fashion?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
But that's probably sacrilegious to suggest such an illustration, but I'm not trying to be.
Yeah. You cannot deny this pattern. It cannot possibly be devised by man or Satan or whatever. This can only be designed by God himself. And I like the quote that Daniel posted, had in his, I don't have the quote here, but about the weight of evidence.
Oh, yes.
I think it applies to this structure right here.
We are to decide on the weight of evidence, not on perfect knowledge.
Yeah.
But man, there's a lot of perfection there. But still.
Yeah.
We don't have perfect knowledge in that we know everything.
But yeah, we can recognize the hand of God in this. Yeah. That's all we need to know. So I have 1 minute left. Can I go a little bit?
Yeah.
Maybe 5 minutes?
Finished off with that material.
This is the last thing I want to explain. So after all this, all these lines that we saw, recently this structure showed up, became clear that there is a connection between the opening up of Rafia and Panium in 2016, that there is a connection between that very date and July 18, 2020. We are now on page 28 of the document. So after all the evidence that we have already seen, we notice that there are 77 weeks between the opening up of Rafia and Panium and Italian camp meeting, where Jeff did his presentation that ended on 9/11. Of the Italian camp meeting, June 9, 2018. There are 77 weeks. And there is another 77 days from there to July 18. This period is 770 days. So you see there are two periods of 77.
Weeks and days.
Weeks, these are weeks and these are days. Aligning up with the line of several snow that both end on July 18. We saw on the line of several snow, we saw the chiasm, the 77 chiasm, with May 2nd pass over in the center of the chiasm. So that was very interesting to see. And it's exactly 187 weeks from December 17, 2016 to July 18, 2020. 187 weeks, of course, a symbol for July 18, right? Mm. And we see also 151 weeks from December 17 to November 9, Rafia.
One of the 25.
Yeah, it's explained in the document, just like the 126. We see 151 also pointing to symbolizing the 2520. Because before the exile, a shekel was 20. And many was 20 shekels. No, I have to say it correctly.
Many was 50 or 60?
Yeah, many was 50 shekels.
And after 60.
And after the exile in Babylon, and many was 60 shekels.
Mm-hmm. So when you take the formula many, many tekel, your parson, you come up with two different numbers
yeah,
depending
on
what
I
many
didn't
you
know
used.
Why they came up with those numbers. I never knew that it had changed in their region.
Yep.
Okay, yeah. That makes better sense.
And now you know. The name Jesus Christ also adds up to 151, by the way.
What's that?
Jesus Christ, the name. If you take the word value of Jesus Christ, it adds up to 151.
Mm-hmm. 151.
Yeah.
The numerical value.
Right.
Of Jesus in the English or Jesus
in the English?
In the English.
Jesus
okay.
Christ.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jesus. Yeah, okay.
So we see the time setting symbol also on in this line, this pattern, pointing towards a Rafia. And we will see the 77 symbology also, again, later on in the study. We see it here two times, 77, 77, 77, 77. And we'll see it again later on in the study, in a very significant way. So it's all connected. This whole history of Raphia and Panim is connected to the very first time that Raphia and Panim were discovered, were opened up. So.
Therefore, when Parminder and Tess are trying to change the understanding of Raphia and Panim that was opened up in Wales, it's another evidence that they're rejecting this particular message.
Amen.
Because Raphia and Panim is part of this message.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So it was the second month.
Yep.
Any questions?
If you add 126 and 151, you get 277. So that's July 27th.
You've got another monster.
Yeah, that's very interesting right there. Mm. Amen. I like it.
Yeah.
Thank you. Shall we close? Dear Father in Heaven, thank you for being able to study these things. Thank you for being able to share these truths, that all the things that we have said and talked about may have an impact on our hearts, that they may have a sanctifying effect, Lord, and that we may realize the solemnness of these things that you have revealed to us, Lord, and please work on our hearts that we are willing to accept these things and see your hand in all these things, Lord. Help us to prepare for closer probation, Lord, and help us to prepare our characters. We ask you all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.